A while back, I did a review of Rossi's R92 rifle, a very cost-effective, modern reproduction of the legendary Winchester 1892. Although it's a nice piece overall, there's no denying the R92's machining is far from stellar. Many of the internal parts suffer from rough surfaces and burring, making for tough operation, particularly in rapid-fire competition settings. Likewise, as with so many other stock guns these days, the factory trigger and mainsprings are way too heavy, resulting in an action that's at times both gritty and stubborn. Fortunately, both these problems can be resolved through the installation of a simple aftermarket spring kit like this one from Lee Gunsmithing and a bit of TLC. With that in mind, today we're going to take a look at the world of cowboy action shooting and slick up this Rossi R92. Let's start by disassembling the rifle. We'll begin by securing in a gun vise and removing the upper tang screw with a slot screwdriver. Next, we'll gently slide the stock free from the receiver. With the receiver exposed, we'll actuate the hammer and slide a push pin through the hole in the mainspring, locking it into place. Now we'll flip the rifle over and remove the pinhole plug screw using a slot screwdriver. With that done, we'll flip the gun a second time and use a punch to tap the bolt pin out. When removing the bolt pin, pay close attention to the orientation. One side features a serrated or splined pattern which needs to be oriented facing left when reinstalling. Now we'll move on to the lever and locking bolts. Actuate the hammer a bit to reduce the tension, then proceed to lower the lever and pull downwards on it to slide it free from the receiver. Again, note the position and orientation of the two locking bolts, as this is important for reassembly later. The bolt with the two slot screws needs to stay on the left, with the other on the right. Using a slot screwdriver, remove the hammer screw. This will free the lower tang, which can then be slid out of place. Note that this is likely an extremely tight fit, and so it may take a certain degree of finessing to remove. As more and more of this gun comes apart, you're really going to start to notice just how rough some of that machining is. Tool marks, sprue and casting lines, and burrs are pretty much everywhere. A lot of this will need to be knocked down and polished smooth if we're going to get this rifle into a competition state. Let's move on to the first spring we'll be replacing. Here we have the trigger spring. As you can see, it's a large, flat leaf with far more tension than is required. After removing the trigger spring screw, we'll go ahead and drop the new one in. Right off the bat, you'll see it's a tiny fraction of the size and tension of the stock model. This will make for a dramatic reduction in trigger pull weight. With the new spring installed, it's time to take a second look at the lower tang. Again, the finish on this part is just abysmal. As mine's at least a few thousandths of an inch too large to fit the receiver properly, I've opted to use medium and fine India stones with some honing oil to take it down. Now it's important to note we're not applying much pressure here. The name of the game is to remove the excess material and smooth the surface while maintaining the original angle of the part. With the honing complete, we'll finish up by using a Dremel tool with a felt bit and some jeweler's rouge to further polish the mating surfaces to a shine. Using just a bit of elbow grease, we've already got this tang looking pretty respectable. Everything's smooth, polished, and straight, which should yield an infinitely better fit than we had when we started. From here, we'll move on to the bolt. To get it out, we'll first need to slide the hammer and spring assembly out of the way. We'll come back to those a little bit later. Now we can grab the bolt and pull it free from the receiver. If you're a machinist by trade, you may want to look away because what you're about to see may be disturbing. Aside from being arguably the most critical moving part in the rifle, this bolt is also by far the roughest. Virtually every surface here is nicked, scratched, covered in tool marks and burrs. There is a ton of work to be done here if we're going to slick this up properly. Before we start on that, let's first discuss the safety. Although the rifle already has a traditional half-cock safety, the R92 also has a secondary safety in front of the hammer. Personally, I don't mind it, but a lot of folks do. If you do decide to remove it, now is definitely the time. Flip the bolt onto its left side and use a punch to remove the locking pin. The mechanism contains a tiny spring and detent ball, both of which are under tension and held in place by nothing more than the bolt itself. Slowly and carefully extract the locking lever, using your fingers to prevent the small parts from ejecting. These are tiny, finely made components, and if you lose them, chances are you will never find them again. With the safety addressed, we can now go ahead and remove the ejector, ejector spring, and collar, all of which should pretty much just fall out on their own. With that done, we finally have the bolt in a state we can begin to work on it. Once again, we'll be using a combination of medium and fine India stones with a generous amount of honing oil to properly finish this part. We want to pay extra close attention to each of the bearing surfaces, slowly stripping away the excess material, removing the tool marks, and softening out the nicks and burrs. Just as with the lower tang, emphasis here is on repetition, not force. We're applying very little pressure and relying on the existing angles to guide our work. The result is a fully finished bolt with smooth, polished bearing surfaces, dramatically reduced friction, and vastly improved fit and function. With the metal work complete, let's return to the remaining springs. Remove the push pin used earlier to capture the main spring and slide it free from the rod. The difference between the stock and new low tension model could not be any more obvious. We'll slide the new spring onto the rod, then pin it in place, leaving it ready to reinstall later. Now we can move on to the lever, or more specifically, the friction stud and spring. With the lever resting on its right side, we'll use a punch to remove the stop pin. As with the previous pins, make sure to take a moment and note the orientation of the serrated side. With the pin removed, the stud slides out easily, revealing the spring beneath. Once again here, we can see a very stark contrast between the stock and reduced tension springs. We'll slide the new one into place, cap it with the stud, and reinsert the pin to secure it. Now we can tackle the ejector spring. Like the main spring, the ejector is way, way too powerful for practical use. Although the new spring is much lighter than the stock model, it's also substantially longer, making it tricky to install with a short ejector rod. As I prefer a light trigger pull anyways, we're going to go ahead and remove an additional 4 loops from the new spring, simplifying installation and further reducing the trigger pull weight. Now we'll simply slide the shortened spring and collar back onto the ejector and slot the whole assembly back into the bolt, noting the orientation. Once the ejector assembly is in place, we'll use a punch to help guide the collar partway down the ejector and into the relief cut, where it'll rest against the ejector spring stop. At this stage, we've now completed all of our metalwork as well as the spring replacements. It's finally time to get this gun back together. We'll begin by reinstalling the bolt in the receiver. To do this, take a spent cartridge casing and slide it into the bolt face, securing the ejector assembly into place. Now it's just a simple matter of guiding the bolt home and confirming it rests flush with the rifle's chamber. With that out of the way, we'll reassemble the lever, ensuring the locking bolt with 2 slot screws is on the left and the one with the stud is on the right. With the lever oriented vertically, we'll line the locking bolts up with their corresponding channels, back the bolt out enough to allow them to pass, and guide the entire assembly into the receiver. When everything's correctly in place, we should be able to close the action, leaving the locking bolts partially exposed and a clear, unobstructed view through the bolt pin hole on the receiver. We can now reinsert the bolt pin, serrated side up, and secure it with a punch. When finished, we'll replace the pinhole plug screw using a slot screwdriver. It's not easy to film, but at this point, the action should be operable. This is a great time to test and make sure the lever actuates the bolt properly. From here, we'll reinstall the hammer and mainspring assembly, followed by the lower tang. Even after slicking up the various parts of this firearm and applying a little bit of lubricating oil, a certain degree of finessing is still going to be necessary to fit the lower tang back into place. As with all things in firearms, take your time and do it right. After adjusting the hammer position to line the various components up, we'll use a slot screwdriver to reinstall the hammer screw. Next, we'll remove the pin securing the mainspring in place, allowing it to return to its natural position. This is also a great time to test the trigger action and ensure everything's mated up properly. Finally, we'll slide the stock back into place and refasten the tang screw to snug it down. And just like that, we have a slicked up lever gun ready for competition. Starting with the trigger pull, thanks to the reduced tension spring kit we installed, we've gone from an average of more than 5 pounds to about 1.5 pounds. That is a huge difference when lining up quick shots and a major competitive advantage. In terms of the action, it's not quite as easy to quantify, but I cannot stress enough how much smoother and faster this gun runs. If I had to guess, I'd say cycling it probably takes less than a quarter of the effort that it used to. Snapping off quick, successive shots is a breeze now, making it easier than ever to stay on target, even when firing rapidly. Last but not least, ejecting a spent cartridge no longer sends it hurtling into the stratosphere, but instead sees it raining down gently about a foot or two away, making post-shooting collection a lot less of a chore. Dollar for dollar, slicking up the Rossi 92 has never been cheaper or simpler. For $50 in parts and a couple hours of your time, you can easily transform a budget plinker into a legitimate competition gun.